parabola. Okay. So first of all, parabola, how is it a conic? How is it obtained from the interaction of a plane with a right circular double cone? In fact, I had already told this in the first class of conic, but still I'll be repeating it. If a right circular double cone, okay, so this is a right circular double cone. If one of the naps, so these are the two naps, and we all know that this is called the semi-vertical angle. If one of the naps is cut by a plane at an angle which is equal to the semi-vertical angle, so something like this. Okay, so as you can see, this is a plane which is cutting this nap at the same angle as alpha. That means this angle, is also alpha. Okay, so this angle is anyways alpha, and this is also alpha. So that means this plane is parallel to the generator over here. So this and this are parallel. So because of this, there is a cross-section area that you would be seeing over here, and that cross-section area will be that of a parabola. Okay, so parabola is nothing but a conic, right? So a conic which is obtained by interaction of a plane with a right circular double cone, where the plane cuts one of the naps at an angle equal to the semi-vertical angle. Okay. Is this fine? Now, as a locus, how do we define a parabola? So what is the locus definition of a parabola? By the way, the definitions which I'm going to use for a parabola, the same would be carried forward, or in fact, with a minor change, in case of an ellipse and hyperbola as well. Okay, so it's very important that you listen to this definition, you know, clearly, because the same definition I'll be using in case of ellipse and hyperbola as well. By the way, in how many of your school has parabola been already completed? Has it been completed in Kormangla, HSR? NPS, okay, Arundhati, completed in HSR. Okay, what about Kormangla? Completed in Kormangla as well. Okay, great. So I think you will be all making sense of whatever I'm going to say. What about DPS and all? Done? Okay. So parabola is basically a path traced by a point moving in a plane moving in a plane in such a way that the ratio of its distance from a fixed point to that from a fixed line is a constant where the constant value is equal to one. Okay, now let me revisit this definition once again. So it's a path traced by a point moving in a plane. Yes, parabola is a two-dimensional figure. Okay, so you draw it on a plane. Okay, in such a way that the ratio of its distance from a fixed point, which is called the focus, to that from a fixed line, which we call as the directrix, is a constant, where this constant is called the eccentricity. That means your eccentricity value is one for a parabola. Now, many people ask me, sir, you told that circle is also a conic because it is obtained by interaction of a plane with a right circular double cone, where the plane cuts one of the naps at an angle 90 degree to the axis. So what is the eccentricity of a circle? I don't know whether I've told you this or not, but for a circle, the eccentricity value is equal to zero. Okay, so please note this down. This will be helpful for your competitive level exam as well. So for a circle, we say the eccentricity value is zero. Okay. For a parabola, which we are doing today, eccentricity value is equal to one. For ellipse, which we'll be doing in our next week session, for ellipse, the eccentricity value is a fraction lying between zero to one. For a hyperbola, it's a value which is greater than one. And for pair of straight lines, which is another degenerate conic, nevertheless, it is a conic. So for pair of straight lines, E value is very, very large, okay, almost tending to infinity. Is it fine? Eccentricity is the ratio of the distance of the point lying on that conic from the focus to the distance from the directrix. That ratio is defined as eccentricity. Got it, Karthik? Okay, I'll show you here. I'll show you. So let's say this is our fixed line and this is our fixed point. Okay. And there is a moving point, let's say P. Okay, this point is a moving point. Let's call it a moving point here. This is a fixed point. Okay, this is a fixed point and this is a fixed line. This is a fixed line. Okay. Now, if this point P moves in such a way that wherever it goes, I'm just drawing few situations here, wherever it goes, its distance from S divided by its distance from D, okay, that fixed line. So SP by PM, this ratio is always one. That means SP is equal to PM, and this ratio is what we call as eccentricity. Okay, so this ratio is what we call as eccentricity. Okay, so eccentricity is one for a parabola. It is zero for a circle. It is some value which is between zero and one for an ellipse. It is some value greater than two for a hyperbola. And if it becomes very, very large, it becomes infinity, almost ending to infinity, then for a pair of straight lines, the eccentricity value is very, very large. Okay. We'll be talking about all those things a little later on. Okay. So if you see the path traced by this point would look like a structure of this nature. Okay. Of course, this is a familiar structure to you. You have already done quadratic polynomials, and the graph of quadratic polynomials are also parabola. Remember, parabola is actually, the word has come from the path taken by the motion of a body thrown under gravity. Okay. Cutting ellipse. Sir, how is that both this definition and cutting ellipse is same? I didn't get your question. See, when it comes to the cone part of it, that requires your understanding of 3D geometry. Okay. First, 2D geometry also, you have not done the concept of, many things. In 3D geometry, later on, you will understand the concept of a cone. And in class 12, you will understand the concept of a plane. So when you study those concepts, you will be able to relate these two definitions. That is why we don't actually go into the depth of the interaction of a plane with a cone, because the knowledge of 3D geometry or the knowledge of three-dimensional bodies, so as to say, is very limited for us. You will explore more about it in your higher courses of mathematics. Okay, because right now you will not make sense about the equation of a cone, equation of a plane, and how they interact to give you a parabola. Okay, so we'll be talking about those. In fact, your engineering professors will be talking about those a little later on. It is just to tell you in the class 11th and 12th that why it is called a conic. That's the only thing you need to know. Okay. So the actual thing that you are supposed to know as a 11th grade student is how a parabola is obtained on a two-dimensional plane. And that is basically explained through the locus concept. This is the locus concept, or this is the locus definition. Okay. So there are a lot of things that you need to, explore and do a research work on it. Could you scroll up? Which part you want me to scroll till? Locus definition, Pratej, or below it? Or to the right side? Now, anybody who wants me to scroll up or down, please give the direction. Up and left, up and right, down and left, down and right. So that I am also clear where to go. Okay, Manu, you're done with your copying of the definition? Okay, so now up and right, Setu wants Swirly to copy this part. Okay, meanwhile, he's copying. Where all you have come across parabola other than your quadratic polynomials? Have you seen parabola in your daily life? Of course, I already gave an example. When you throw a ball at somebody, the ball takes a parabolic path before reaching the hands of that person, right? Anywhere else you have seen a parabola? Okay, probably you would have observed the headlamps of your car. They are actually parabolic projectors, okay? Or they are parabolic lamps. One of the very important features of a parabola is in a parabola, there is something called axis. So we'll talk about that also, okay? So if there is a ray of light which is coming parallel to the axis, after hitting the parabolic reflector, it always will pass through the focus. So it's always going to pass through the focus, okay? And the same is true for the reverse direction also. You know, light, reversibility of direction of light is always true. So if a ray of light starts from the focus, after hitting the parabolic reflector, it becomes parallel to the axis. Now there is a proof for this. But for that proof, you need to know the concept of normal and tangents also. We'll talk about it when we are doing this chapter in more depth. Right now, we are only limiting ourselves to school curriculum. So because of this, if you have a parabolic reflector in your car, when you light the bulb which is at the focus, the bulb light after hitting the glass of the parabolic reflector or the mirrored surface of the parabolic reflector will become parallel to the axis. That means if the driver of the car wants to see far on the road, okay, he will switch on this light. Okay. If he switches on the other light, which is not at the focus, then basically after hitting it, it will converge. It'll come back to the, let's say if there is a bulb over here, let's say I'm just putting a bulb over here, then this bulb after hitting the car will maybe converge like this. Okay. It will not become parallel. Okay. So there are, multiple bulbs in the headlight of the car. As you can see, the driver will always, use a dipper and all those things. So basically he changes the position of the, basically he lights up a different bulb kept at different positions. Okay. That is how he can see far off on the road. Earlier there were used to be spherical mirrors, but there were problems with the spherical mirrors, like spherical aberrations. That is why the parabolic mirrors have replaced those spherical mirrors in the modern cars. Another application is in treating the stones, kidney stones. So what do doctors do? They will keep the kidney stone at the focus of the parabolic reflector and they will pass a laser beam. So the laser beam on hitting the parabolic reflector will pass through the, and will pass through the focus, thereby damaging that stone, kidney stone, and thereby curing that problem. Is it fine? Any questions? All right. So any point that you take, let's say I take this point. So this divided by this, okay, that will also be, ratio will be one. So any point you take on this parabolic surface, okay, so this length will always be equal to this length. Okay. So let me show you this demonstration on GeoGebra also, that if I take a parabola and choose any point on the parabola, the ratio of its distance from the focus to that from the directrix will always be a one. So let me show that to you. Oh, one second. Yeah. I'll take a simple parabola, y square is equal to 4x. Maybe most of you who have already done it would know that this equation is of a standard parabola. We will talk about it, don't worry. So those who are wondering, how did sir write this parabola equation? This is one of the standard cases of a parabola, which I'll be taking up very soon with you. Now, this tool has a facility that it can actually tell you the focus. Okay. But please don't misuse it for your Kemon test. Okay. So it can tell you the focus. See, it has told you the focus. Focus is at 1, 0. And this tool can also tell you the directrix. Wonderful tool. Okay. So see, it has shown you the directrix. Now, if you take any point on this parabola, let's say I take this point. Okay. And from this point, I drop a perpendicular onto the directrix. Okay. And let's see the lengths. So length from B to the focus is H, and H value is right now 4.64, as you can see on the left side of the software. Okay. And from B to C, the length is I, which is again 4.64. Okay. So this ratio of H by I, that is what we call A. In this case, they have called it as A. That A is what we call as the eccentricity. Okay. So that ratio is called eccentricity. In case of a parabola, it is 1. Okay. Now see, I will make this point B dance on this parabola. Just have a close eye on A value. You would realize that A is not changing. A is always a 1. Or in other words, H and I are always taking same values. See, 1.43, 1.43. 1.9, 1.9, 2.91, 2.91. So wherever you go, that ratio will always be equal to 1. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns here? No, we don't define eccentricity for x cube and all. Okay, so eccentricity is only defined for conic sections, which happens to be a second degree general equation curves. Okay, this is a third degree. So eccentricity and all will not be defined for such curves. Okay. All right. So with this, we are now going to learn certain terms associated with a parabola. These will be the new terms for you vis-a-vis your circles, because in circles, you had hardly center and radius and maybe a chord or something, or x-intercept, y-intercept is what you learned. But in case of a parabola, you will be learning plethora of terms. So what are those terms? Let's talk about it. And these terms would also be used in your other conic as well, like ellipse and hyperbola. So terms used in parabola. So first, let me draw a parabola. Normally for making a parabola, I do some weird things. I just make an ellipse. I just chop off the half part, but let me tell you that this doesn't mean that half of an ellipse is a parabola. Please don't take that into consideration. It is only to facilitate drawing of the graph. That is why I'm using it. Okay. So don't start saying, oh, ellipse is half, parabola is half of an ellipse. Nothing like that. Okay. Now, all of you, please pay attention. Let me also draw the directrix. Okay, please ensure that you are roughly following the fact that directrix, any point on the ellipse is equidistant from the focus as well as the directrix. Okay, now all of you please pay attention. This you already know the name focus. No issues with that. Okay, this is called the directrix. Don't start calling it as a dielectric. There was some teacher I was interviewing 2 years back, and I still could not forget the day. Not 2 years, maybe 3 years back, just before COVID began. So he was calling directrix as dielectric. The one which you'll study in physics, maybe when you do capacitors and all. So he was constantly calling it as dielectric. I was like 5 minutes, I could not understand what is this dielectric doing in mathematics. So then I realized, oh, he's talking about directrix. Okay. So please do not mispronounce it. Thankfully, this year you also may not have a KVPY essay viva, but if it does and you're using a wrong pronunciation, that really turns off the professors, okay, who are very old and experienced. They don't like you know, misuse of words, especially when it comes to your mathematical terms. Anyways, now there's a line which connects the focus and perpendicular to the directrix. That line is called the axis of the parabola. So this line that you see, this line is called the axis of the parabola. So axis of a parabola is a line perpendicular to the directrix passing through the focus. Axis divides the parabola into symmetrical halves. It divides the parabola into symmetrical halves. Okay. The point where the axis cuts the parabola, that point is called the vertex of the parabola. Okay. So this is axis, this is vertex, this is focus, this is directrix. A line segment joining any two points on the parabola is called a chord. So if I connect any two points on it, okay, so this is a chord. Okay, we'll talk about chord also a little later on. Okay. If the chord passes through the focus, I'll use some different colors for everything. Okay. If the chord passes through the focus, then that chord will be called as a focal chord. So this is a focal chord. Okay. A chord which is perpendicular to the axis. Let's say I draw a chord like this. Okay. This is perpendicular to the axis. This is called as a double ordinate. D-U-B-L-E. Double ordinate. R-D-I-O. I think I'll be, yeah. Double ordinate. So double ordinate is a chord which is perpendicular to the axis of the chord. Okay. Next. The most important term that you'll be, you know, hearing from your school teachers, you know, or in the exam also it is asked, lattice rectum. Okay, so what is a lattice rectum? Lattice rectum is a focal chord which is also a double ordinate, or vice versa. It's a double ordinate which is also a focal chord. That means this angle is a 90 degree and it is passing through the focus also. This word has come, this is a Latin word. Lattice means side, rectum means line. It's a side line. Okay, so some names were given to these geometrical figures way back, very early when maths was evolving, and those same names have been carried forward even till date. Okay, just to honor those initial mathematicians who named them. Okay, so this is called the lattice rectum, means side line. Okay, later on you'll come to know something about lattice rectum, that lattice rectum is the shortest focal chord in a parabola. That means there is no focal chord shorter than the lattice rectum. Okay, so lattice rectum is the shortest focal chord in the parabola. So few terms or few things that I would like to make you note down so that you are clear about it. Let's say this is end point. Please note down number one, the vertex is the midpoint of S and N. Is the midpoint of S and N. See, you've seen the diagram, this is your S. This is your N. Vertex is always a midpoint. Okay. Second thing, axis is always perpendicular. Axis is always perpendicular to the directrix. And focus always lies on the directrix. Sorry, focus always lies on the axis. Okay. So remember, axis will always contain the focus. Okay. Vertex, and it will be perpendicular to the directrix. Lattice rectum is the focal chord, which is also a double ordinate, and vice versa. Also a double ordinate. Okay. And later on, we'll prove this in today's session. It is the shortest focal chord. So lattice rectum is the shortest focal chord of the parabola. Okay. Any questions, any concerns? Now, having known these terms, please note that the same terms will be carried forward to our other conics as well, like ellipse and hyperbola. So if you have any doubt with respect to any term, why it is called double ordinate? Many people ask this question. It is because the endpoints of the double ordinate have the same y coordinate, just differing in sign. That is why it is called double ordinate, because the endpoints of the double ordinate are symmetrically positioned about the axis. Okay. That's the reason why it is called double ordinate. Okay. So now with this, we are going to introduce the elements of coordinate geometry to our chapter. So we are ultimately studying coordinate geometry. So equations, etc. are bound to come. Okay. So we have to study about equations, coordinates, etc. So I'll be starting my today's discussion with standard parabolae. Equations of standard parabolae. By the way, parabolae or parabolas, both are acceptable word for plural of parabola. Okay, you can use both of them. So there are four standard cases that we are going to discuss today. But first of all, why they are called standard cases, or which cases are called standard cases? So first of all, standard cases are those cases which will be used most frequently in deriving certain property. As I already told you, standard cases are like frogs in the laboratory. So we do so much of experiment, no, on these animals, on frog, lizard, etc. in the bio lab, right? Because they're easy to handle, they can easily be found out, okay? And they help us understand the human anatomy as well. So standard parabola is the most simplest form of a parabola. And many a times, any property or something, you know, related to a generic parabola, we derive on a standard case because easy to manage. As you can see from their equations, when we derive it, they look very simple and, you know, hassle-free. Okay. So standard parabolas are those parabolas whose vertices is kept at origin. Okay. And axis is either of the coordinate axes. That means those parabola whose vertex is at origin and axis is either the x-axis or the y-axis, those cases are basically called standard cases. Remember when we did circles, I had also told you the standard case for a circle. So circle whose center is at origin, that is called standard case. In our parabola, the standard cases are those cases where the vertex is at origin and your axis of the parabola is either along your x-axis or along y-axis. So as a result of, you know, satisfying these two conditions, four standard cases actually stand out, or four standard cases get formed. So let us take our first standard case. This first standard case, I call it as a rightward opening parabola. Now, this is a word which I use. You might not see this word in your textbooks. Okay, so I call it as a rightward opening parabola. So how does it look like? So let me again draw a parabola for you. Okay, so I'll just chop this arm off. Okay, so what do? In this case, we keep the vertex at the origin. In other words, our axis, we will call it as, let's say, the x-axis. Okay, so let's say this is our axis of the parabola, and I'll, you know, take it as my x-axis, and this is origin. Okay, so if this is origin, you're bound to have your y-axis going like this. Okay, so this is your y-axis. Okay, and you can also show your directrix also somewhere over here. So directrix is also here. Okay, now in order to write the equations, we need to use our locus condition. What is the locus condition? That any point on this particular parabola, its distance from the focus should be equal to its distance from the directrix. So for that, at least I have to fix where is the focus. Now, since focus lies on the x-axis, I will consider some point A, 0 to be focus. Okay. Now, please understand that this A term that we are using is representing a distance over here, the distance between the vertex and the focus. Okay, so this represents the distance between the vertex and the focus. And that is why we always take our A value as positive. So this is very, very important, right? You rarely find me writing VVIP, IMP, okay? So I normally write important or note, but this is very, very important to note that A represents the distance between the focus and the directrix. And hence, A is taken to be positive always. Never make a mistake about it. Okay. So many people will put a point on the negative side also when we talk about leftward opening parabola, and they start calling it also as A comma zero. No, that point should be called minus A comma zero, because A is always taken to be positive because it represents the distance between the focus. Sorry, what did I write? Focus and the vertex. Focus and the vertex. Sorry. Okay. Is it fine? Now, since origin is the midpoint of N and S, it's automatically understood that N will become minus A comma zero. And since your directrix is perpendicular to the axis and axis is your X axis, that means this line becomes parallel to Y axis. So this line equation will become X equal to minus A, or you can say X plus A equal to zero. Yes or no? Yes or no? Ashlesha, blue line is the directrix. White line I've already written over here, y-axis. If you want, I can write directrix on top of it. Got it? All right. Now we will use our locus definition to get our equation of the ellipse. Parabola. Why did I say ellipse? Oh, yesterday I had a class on ellipse. That's why. Sorry. Okay, so let's take a generic point, h comma k. This distance and this distance should be equal. Okay, so as per the definition, SP should be equal to PM. Okay, that means this ratio should be equal to 1. Now, what is SP? SP, as you can easily use your distance of two points formula, h minus a the whole square, k minus 0 the whole square, under root, equal to PM. Now, what is the distance of a point from a line? We already know that in our straight lines chapter, we had done it. So we put the coordinates of the point in the left side here, x plus a. We take a mod of that and divide by the squares of the coefficient of x and y, which will give you mod h plus a by under root of 1 square. Isn't it? Anybody has any doubt with the right side expression? Do let me know. Anybody? Okay. So once we have got this, let us square both the sides. By the way, root 1 square is as good as a 1. So you can skip that part and just write h plus a the whole square. Remember, mod h plus a whole square and h plus a whole square means the same thing. Okay. Now just expand it. You'll have h square, a square minus 2h. This will be h square, a square plus 2h. You will end up losing, I think, h square, a square. Yeah. And you'll end up getting k square is equal to 4ah. Now, once you have got it, generalize this. Generalize this by writing h as x and k as a y, which leads to our equation of the first standard case, or you can say a rightward opening parabola, as y square is equal to 4ax. As you can see, this equation seems to be so simple, and that's the reason why it is basically used for finding or proving many properties in parabola. So they are called standard cases. Is this fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? Okay. So once you have found it out, let us also find out the length of the lattice rectum. Okay. Let us also find out the length of the lattice rectum. Maybe I'll take a separate diagram here. Okay. Let's find out the length of the lattice rectum. Okay, I'm already showing you the x-axis and the y-axis. Okay, directrix I need not show, it's not required. And let's say this is our latus rectum. So latus rectum will pass through the focus and perpendicular to the axis. Okay. So let me call it as LR. This point is your A, 0. So how do you find LR length? Very simple. Let's say L coordinate is A, something. Okay. Please note, since the latus rectum is parallel to the directrix or Y axis, you can say on the latus rectum, your X coordinate will always be A. Okay. So I can easily take the L coordinates to be A, K. Now A, K will satisfy your equation that we have just now derived. So this satisfies Y square is equal to 4AX. So in place of Y, put a K. In place of X, you put a A. So you end up getting K square as 4A square, which means K is plus minus 2A. Okay. Now, which is plus 2A and which is minus 2A? Which is plus 2A and which is minus 2A? Who will tell me? Is L ordinate to A or is R's ordinate to A? Who will tell me? And why? Why not this is minus 2A? Why not L is having an ordinate of minus 2A? Right, Sharduli. Because as I already told you, and I wrote VVIP also, IMP also for that, your A is always positive. So since you're above the x-axis, the above one is 2A, the below one is minus 2A. So in light of this, we can easily, you know, figure out what is the length of the latus rectum. So the length of the latus rectum will be 4A units. 4A units. It's not like first quadrant A is Vaishnav. Again, same mistake you're doing. Whether first, second, third, fourth, seventh, eighth, hundredth quadrant. Sorry for, you know, that hyperbole. But A will always be positive because A represents the distance between the vertex and the focus. It doesn't depend on the quadrant. Let it be clear here. Okay. The reason I wrote VVIMP for that is because despite telling people make mistakes and that costs them the problem. Okay. So please make no mistakes about it. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns with respect to the first standard case, which is your rightward opening parabola? Okay. Now this image that you have, this should be implanted in your mind. That means you should clearly know when you close your eyes, where is the focus? What is the equation of the directrix? What is the length of the latus rectum? Where is the vertex? Which is your axis, etc. Everything should be there in your mind. The moment you close your eyes and imagine this, everything should be clear. Okay. So with this, we can now move on. Yes, yes, Vaishnav, sure. So with this, we now move on to the second standard case. Yes, Anushka. Any questions? Latus rectum, first of all, it is latus rectum. Times the equation of the parabola is a coincident. I didn't get that question. You're saying the coefficient of X here is the latus rectum? That's what you're trying to say? Yes, actually, it's not a coincident. There's an alternate definition. We will talk about that a little later on. See, equation of a parabola is actually like this. But I don't want to discuss about it because it is beyond your school level right now. Equation of a parabola is nothing but it's any point on the parabola. Okay. It's distance from the axis. Distance from the axis square is latus rectum times distance distance from the tangent at the vertex. Distance from tangent at the vertex. Later on, we'll discuss about it. See, when you wrote y square is equal to 4x, so y is what? Y is actually, let's say this point is x comma y. So y is the distance on the axis. So you're squaring that up. See, distance on the axis square is equal to 4a. 4a is actually the length of the lattice sector that you were telling Sharduli. And what is x? X is nothing but it's the distance from the tangent at the vertex. Okay, so that x that you wrote is the distance of the tangent, sorry, distance of the point from the tangent at the vertex. Okay, point from the tangent at the vertex. But right now we are not going to discuss it because it's anyways a part and parcel of our regular chapter when we do it for competitive level exam point of view. But I think you identified it, so that's why I am discussing it. So this y is actually distance from axis. Okay. So many times this definition is used when somebody provides you with a, you know, let's say some orbit axis equation, and let's say he provides you with the equation of a tangent at the vertex. So this equation can also be utilized. We will discuss about it later in more detail. Don't worry. Now we are going to talk about the second standard case. So second standard case would be a case where the vertex is at origin. Okay, the vertex of the parabola is at origin. The axis is still the x-axis. But this time the focus, let me make a white line. Yeah. This time the focus of the parabola is on the negative x-axis. So as you can see here from the diagram, this is your positive x-axis, positive y-axis. So this is a leftward opening parabola and the focus here is at minus a comma zero. Now see, I could have easily wrote a comma zero also, where I would say a is a negative quantity. But as I already told you, we always take a to be a positive quantity and hence, I have to put this external negative sign to show that the focus lies on the negative x-axis. Okay. So the vertex here is still at origin and the directrix will be, I'm just going to make them very quickly. The directrix is going to be x equal to a line. Okay. So for such cases, you don't have to derive the equation once again. However, if you want to, you can. But why to waste time when we have already done transformation of graphs in our bridge course? So you tell me, how is this equation of this parabola related to the equation of the previous parabola? Of course, after observing that one is the mirror image of the other about y-axis, how would you get this equation without deriving it from scratch? What will you do? Write it down in the chat box. Replace x with the minus x. Absolutely, Setu. So in the previous parabola, if you replace your x with a minus x, you end up getting the equation of this parabola. Because whenever a graph is reflected about the y-axis, we change the sign of x to a minus x. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? So please note this down. Critical things are equation of the directrix, which is x equal to a, focus now becomes minus a comma zero, vertex is 0, 0 still. Equation becomes y square is equal to minus 4x and there would be no change in the lattice rectum length. Lattice rectum length will be still 4a units only. So just taking a mirror image about y-axis doesn't change the dimension. So many people also want to know that is lattice rectum always 4 times the distance between the vertex and the focus? Yes. So this can be noted down. Note that. In fact, I would write it in the very first slide where we talked about lattice rectum for the first time. I think we had taken here. Yeah. So lattice rectum is always 4 times the distance between focus and the vertex. Is that fine? Any questions, any concerns? All right. So in the same page, I will take the other two cases as well. So altogether, there are four cases. Okay, two of them we have already taken care. Can you go back to the slide, to the LR note you just gave? Four times the distance between. Thank you. 1 second. Oh, sorry. I think it is on slide number 4. 4 times the distance between the focus and the vertex. Copied, Pratej. Setu and all. Then. Okay. So, two cases we have already done. Now we are going to talk about the case where the parabola is going to open upwards. Okay. This is the most commonly seen parabola by us. We had also seen this in our polynomial functions chapter. Okay. So this is an upward opening parabola. The vertex is still at origin. So let me just showcase your coordinate axis here. This is your y-axis. This is your x-axis. Okay. Y-axis, x-axis. This is your vertex. So in this case, the directrix equation will become, let me just write down the critical points. Focus is 0, comma a. Directrix is y equal to minus a. Y equal to minus a. Okay. Now, in this case, if I ask you this question, that using our first standard form, can you get the equation of this standard form? What will you do for that? How is this figure and the first standard parabola related to each other? Right, absolutely. Please note that this figure is nothing but the first standard case turned 90 degree. Now, turning a 90 degree is equivalent to saying taking reflection about y equal to x line. Okay. Now, see here, I'll show you in a very small diagram here. This is your y square is equal to 4x, right? Let's say I make a line like this, which is y equal to x line. And I start taking the mirror image of this white parabola about this blue line. Assume that this blue line is silvered on both sides. So this bulge, as you can see, I'm moving my cursor on it or pen on it. This bulge will look like this. Okay. This will look like this. And this fellow will look like this. So ultimately, you'll end up getting an upward opening parabola. Okay, so you don't have to derive the equation from scratch. So in y square is equal to 4ax, just swap the positions of x and y. That is how we normally reflect any curve. So if any curve is reflected about y equal to x line, in that, for the reflected curve, we just swap the position of x and y. Okay. So this will become x square is equal to 4ay. Please note this down. And lattice rectum length will still remain 4a units. No impact on the lattice rectum length because of this reflection. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. The fourth case is where your parabola is opening downwards. That also I will show it here itself. Okay. So vertex is still at the origin. Okay, this is a vertex. The focus now becomes 0, comma, minus A. Okay. And this becomes your directrix. Directrix is Y equal to A. Y equal to A. So for such case, as you have already seen, change your Y with a minus Y because you are reflecting something about the X axis. So when there's a reflection about the X axis, we normally change the sign of Y. And again, in this case, lattice rectum length still remains to be 4A units. Okay. So altogether, we have four standard cases of the parabola. Y square is equal to 4AX. Y square is equal to minus 4AX. X square is equal to 4AY. And X square is equal to minus 4AY. And let me tell you, out of these four cases, the very first one is the more common one. The Y square is equal to 4AX. Okay. Many experiments which we perform in parabola, we perform it on Y square is equal to 4AX. Okay, Shardali has a question. If anything is reflected about, say, Y equal to 3X sine or... Okay. Will Y be reflected, replaced with 3X? Okay, now see, if anything is reflected about Y equal to 3X sine, we have to use our concept of rotation by a matrix. Okay, normally this matrix we'll be talking about in class 12. Any Y equal to tan X theta, there is a rotation matrix which is associated. Okay, and that rotation matrix has got 2 theta into it. Are you getting my point? So what do we do? Let me just tell you, you know, very straightforward what happens actually. When you're reflecting something or when you're rotating something, okay, by an angle of theta, you are actually multiplying it with something like this. A matrix comes into picture. Okay. So this matrix, okay, this matrix, in fact, this is minus, this is plus, yeah. Okay. So this matrix is responsible for giving you the new coordinate. Okay, so this matrix is what we call as the rotation matrix. Rotation matrix. Okay. By the way, I've written it for a point. For a curve, it will be minus will come on this side. But this is something which you will not understand right now because it requires your understanding of linear algebra. A bit of linear algebra, which means some matrices information is required. So if you're reflecting a curve about Y equal to 3X, 3 becomes your tan theta, okay? And with that theta, you have a rotation matrix which gets formed. Let me tell you, it will have 2 theta into its angles. So what you are saying, that will not exactly hold valid, okay? That is going to give you a completely different result, okay? That's not going to be as simple as replacing Y equal to 3X. So a matrix gets formed, rotation matrix, which has got twice of the angle by which you want to rotate it, that involved there. Okay, I'll give you the result in some time. Maybe after the break, I'll give you that result. What does result give you? Okay. Yes, see what happens. Yes, in our result, theta was 45 degrees because you're rotating it about Y equal to X line. So cos theta minus sine theta, cos theta, when it gets multiplied, it basically sends that point to it rotates it. So that 2 theta will come into picture. So 2 theta will be 90 degrees. So cos 90 degree, sine 90 degree, minus sine 90 degree, cos 90 degree will come into picture. So if you know a bit of matrix multiplication, you can realize that some point, let's say A comma B will become B comma A in that case. But in general, we will not like to waste everybody's time over here. We will talk about it. In fact, if you want to see that, you can watch one of my videos on matrices, especially the last session of the matrices where I've talked about how do the curves get transformed when you're reflecting it about certain line? But it is definitely not the way you are thinking it to be. Okay. So the next thing that we are going to talk about is questions. So first type of question which I'll be asking you is your understanding of the locus definition. Let's take a question which is based on the locus understanding of your parabola. Here's the question. Find the equation of the parabola whose focus is at -1, -2 and the directrix is a straight line. x - 2y + 3 = 0. Please try this question and give me a response on the chat box. Yes, anybody, any success? You can give your response on the chat box. Okay, Nikhil. Anybody else? This is just based on your locus definition. That's it. Nothing else you have to do. Very good, Arif. Anybody else? All right, let's discuss this, guys. This is very simple. See, if I just draw the scenario on the coordinate axes. So there is a directrix x minus 2y plus 3 equal to 0. If you just sketch this up, it's going to be a line like this, okay, having a slope of 1 by 2 and cutting the y-axis at 3 by 2, okay? And there's a point minus 1 comma minus 2, maybe somewhere over here, okay? So your directrix is in this fashion and your focus is at minus 1 comma minus 2. And let's say this is your parabola. I'm just drawing a rough sketch of a parabola. Now, every point that you take on the parabola would be satisfying the fact or will be satisfying the locus definition that the distance of P from the focus should be same as the distance of P from the directrix. Okay. Let me draw this S slightly closer to the point. It's looking somewhere in between. Yeah, this is your S. Okay. So if you make this locus condition get satisfied by this point P, let's say H comma K, you can write SP. SP would be under root of H minus minus 1, which is H plus 1, K minus minus 2, which is K plus 2, equal to PM. Now, PM length would be nothing but distance of H comma K from this given line, which will be H minus 2K plus 3 mod by under root of 1 square minus 2 square. Okay, Noel, we'll check. So take this term to the left side and square it. By the way, this is root 5. And if you square it, you will end up seeing something like this. Okay. When you expand it, by the way, you already know that I don't write everything. I expand it, you know, just by finding the coefficients of each type of term. So let us first focus on h square. So 5h square will come from here. H square will come from here. So you'll be left with 4h square. You'll have 5k square and you'll have 4k square. So you'll be left with a k square. And here you'll end up getting minus 4hk, which when it comes to the right left side will give you 4hk. Then from here you'll have 10h and from here you'll have 6h. So that will leave you with a 4h on the left. On this side, you will have 20k. And this side, you will have minus 12k. So 20 and minus 12 will add. So it will become 32k. And constant terms will be 25 minus 9, which is 16. Okay. So now you can generalize it by replacing your h with an x and k with a y. That leaves you with the final answer as 4x square plus y square plus 4xy plus 4x plus 32y plus 16 equal to 0. Now, this question was given as an eye-opener question to many of you who actually just remember the standard form, not knowing from where it has come. So it has come from a locus condition, and locus condition is something that helps us to find answers to any general form of a parabola as well. Another eye-opener here was, oh, the parabola equation can get so ugly also. I always thought it was y square is equal to 4ax or y square is equal to minus 4ax or x square is equal to 4ay. Please understand, those are standard forms. Those are the simplest form of a parabola. Okay. So your parabola, as any other conic, can have all types of terms. X square, y square, xy, x, constant, y, etc. So don't make a false image in your mind that whenever somebody says parabola, you always think of y square is equal to 4ax. So that's a very, very special case. Is it fine? Well done. I think most of you got it right. But let me see who was the first person to get this right. Nikhil was the first person to get this right, followed by Arav Sinha. Well done, guys. Setu, I don't know what you have written also. Setu, you have done the same thing which I told many people do. All parabolas are not y square is equal to 4ax. So, it's a simple case out of a lot of cases. Okay. Are you getting my point? All right. So let's take a few other types of questions. Many examples that are present over here, they are basically related to, okay. So I'll take another case here. Find the position of the vertex, focus, equation of directrix. Length of lattice sector. Okay. For the following cases. Number one, y square is equal to x. Number two, y square is equal to minus 8x. Number three, x square is equal to 4y. And number four, x square is equal to minus 16y. Okay. So for each of these cases, please note that I have given you purposely the simplest one, the standard cases. So for each of these cases, we need to write down the four things here. Please do it and give your response in one go. Yes, I'll talk about those necessary conditions, Nikhil, in our pair of straight lines chapter. In a pair of straight lines, when we have completed all our conic, we'll talk about the generic condition for a second degree equation to represent a parabola. Okay. There is something called a symmetric determinant. You will read it in some time. Okay. So that all conditions we'll be talking about in that chapter. Yeah, sorry. I think there was a power cut because of that. You lost the touch. Can you all hear me properly? Okay. Done. Okay, excellent. Let's discuss it one by one. All right. So for the first case, if you just compare it with y square is equal to 4ax, it means your 4a is 1. So your a is 1/4. Okay. And now, where is the vertex? So for the first one, vertex will be at origin because it is a standard case, correct? Focus will be at a comma zero. Let me write that down. Focus will be at a comma zero. Okay. Next is your equation of the directrix. Equation of the directrix will be x equal to minus a. Equation of directrix, x equal to minus a, which is minus 1/4. And finally, you have lattice rectum length, which is 4a units. 4a unit means 1 unit. Clear? Any questions with the first one? Okay, so let me write it like Roman number 1. Yeah. So for the second one, are you all ready with your answers? Should we discuss the second one or you want some more time? Done? Should we discuss it? Okay. Yeah. So let's discuss it. So for this case, you have to compare it with y square is equal to 4ax again. Sorry, minus 4ax again. So who will tell me what is the a value in this case? For the second case, what is your a value? Ayo, Noel. I'm sure you did that to frustrate me, right, Noel? I keep on saying this. I'm repeating it again. A is positive always. Always positive. No minus 2 business. Please note that. Okay. So A here is 2. So you have to compare it with minus 4ax. So A is 2. So the moment you know that it is y square is equal to minus 4ax, you know it's a leftward opening parabola. So vertex is still at origin. Okay. Vertex will be still at origin. Focus will be, I'm so sorry. Second one. Yeah. Focus will be minus a comma zero. Okay. Equation of the directrix will be x equal to a. Okay. And your length of the lattice rectum will be 4a units, which in this case will be equal to 8 units. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions, any concerns? Next, x square is equal to 4y. Are you all done with the third one? Let me write it here. X square is equal to 4y. Yes, they're all standard cases. So you realize the vertex will always be 0, 0. Okay. By the way, here A is 1. So focus here will be, now close your eyes, everybody. Everybody close your eyes and imagine that there's an upward opening parabola. Where should be the focus? 0, comma A. So it'll be 0, comma 1. Correct? Equation of directrix will be y equal to minus A, or you can say y plus 1 equal to 0. And the length of the lattice rectum will be 4a units, which is equal to 4 units only. How do we know a is 1? Compare this with 4ay. So 4 is equal to 4a. A is 1. Last case. X square is equal to minus 16y. So before you start, I would like to ask you, what is a value here? Write it down on the chat box. Thanks for writing that extra plus, Shardili. A is? Noel? Yeah, Noel, don't make that mistake again. So A is 4. Good. Wow, minus minus four. Ah. Put two more, no? Minus 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 four. Okay, now let's close your eyes. Everybody close your eyes and imagine a downward opening parabola. Okay, so everything related to that should be appearing in your mind. Vertex was 0, 0. No issues with vertex. Focus was 0, comma, minus A. Correct? Equation of the directrix will be y equal to a, and the length of the lattice sectum will be 4a units, which in this case will be 16. So this number itself is the length of the lattice rectum. Okay. So these are all simpler cases which probably your school exams or unit tests you will be asked. Okay. So we'll quickly make our move towards the shifted form of a parabola. Okay. We'll discuss about shifted form of a parabola. And we will also do a question or certain set of questions related to shifted parabola that will be more challenging than this. Is it fine? Anything that you would like to ask, copy, get clarification on, do let me know. Okay. So shifted parabole. Now let me test your understanding of your coordinate geometry, a review of coordinate geometry a bit here. Let's say I had a standard form of a parabola. Y square is equal to 4ax. Let me draw it. Ayyo. This was your y square is equal to 4ax. Now, the same parabola now shifts to this position. Okay, the same x-axis, y-axis. Now the same parabola shifts to this position. That means it becomes like this. Let me change the color. I have already used green for the axes. Maybe I'll use a blue one. Okay. Now, my question to all of you here is that if the vertex is alpha comma beta, if the vertex here is alpha comma beta, where did you shift your origin such that this parabola, the white parabola, became the blue parabola? Think carefully and answer. I'll repeat my question once again. If you want to make your white parabola as the blue parabola, where did you shift your origin? Wrong, Shardulee. So how would you say that, Arav? You're on the right tracks. So how would you, where has your origin gone? Right, Nikhil. Your origin has actually gone to minus alpha minus beta. Right? Please note, the curve doesn't shift. What shifts? The origin shifts. So if you want to make that curve go up and right, let us say, I'm taking a sample here, then your origin should go exactly the same units down and left. So as a result, see, your origin was at vertex over here. Now your vertex became alpha beta. That means origin would have gone to minus alpha minus beta. Correct? So because of this, what will be the effect on the equation of the parabola? So how would this get transformed? What would be the new equation? What would be the new equation? Who will tell me? If origin shifts to minus alpha minus beta, what will happen to the equation y square is equal to 4ax? What would be the new equation? Tell me. Write it down on the chat box. What are you going to change your x with? What are you going to change your y with? Wrong, Nikhil. Wrong, Sharduli. Guys, I need to revisit now shifting of origin concept. I think you have all forgotten that. And with no fault of yours, because you know, in school and all, we don't practice any questions based on this. See, everybody, please pay attention. If your origin shifts to a point, I'm just doing a recall. Okay, recall for you all. Review of coordinate system. If your origin shifts to h, k, okay. How does your x, y get changed? Let's say x, y becomes capital X, capital Y. So what is your capital X? Capital X is small x minus h. Okay. Or in other words, x is small x is capital X plus h. Correct. And how does your y get changed? Capital Y is small y minus k. That is to say, small y is capital Y plus k. Okay, that is how the transformation happens to a point. How does a curve get changed? So let's say there's a curve whose equation is this. So this is the old equation. What would be the new equation here? What would be the new equation here? So you will say, sir, same thing. Change your small x with capital X plus h and change your y with capital Y plus k. Correct? This will become the new equation, right? Now here, mind you shifted your origin to minus alpha minus beta. So minus alpha is your h, minus beta is your k. Are you getting my point? So your small x, let me write the equation again. So your small x will be changed with x plus h, which is x minus alpha in this case. And your y will be changed with capital Y. Let me write it in capitals only just for the time being. Okay. And your y will be changed with y plus k, which in this case will be capital Y minus beta. Okay. But as I told you in that coordinate geometry class also, it is not a good practice to write equations in capital alphabets. So, right, what do? We write it in small alphabets. Okay. Small alphabets or small letters. Okay. So it becomes y minus beta the whole square 4a x minus alpha. This becomes your new equation. Or you can also apply your graphical transformation concepts that if a curve moves, let's say, assuming that it is moving right and up. So right means x will get changed with x minus that quantity by which it is moving right, or that many units by which it is moving right. And if it goes up, y will be changed by y minus that many units by which it is moving up. Is this fine? Any questions? Prishyam also, no, that is not correct. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? So you have to be, you know, careful, you know, while doing this concept, because right now it was a simple case. You could have, you know, managed here. But when it comes to your complicated problems, especially when it comes to the problems related to homogenization, which you will study in pair of straight lines, any such mistake will lead to a waste of a lot of time, effort, and of course, you'll get a wrong answer. So be very, very clear, okay, with respect to your shifting of origin. How does it impact an equation? How does it impact the coordinate of a point? Is it fine? All right. Now, many type of questions can be framed on this. They may give you a shifted version of a parabola, and they might ask you for vertex coordinate, focus coordinate, equation of directrices. They may also ask you for the equation of the axis, lattice rectum, etc., etc. Okay. So let us take an example based on the same and try to understand from that example that if a question comes where my parabola is a shifted parabola, then how do I figure out its vertex, focus, equation of the directrix, equation of the axis, length of the lateral septum, and so on and so forth. Okay, so let us learn through an example. So can we move on? By the way, the same concept can be applied to any standard form. So I'm not separately talking about y square is equal to minus 4x, or x square is equal to 4ay, or x square is equal to minus 4ay. In all those, you have to apply a similar strategy. Okay, is it fine? Okay, by the way, just to ensure everybody has understood this concept, I would take a problem here. Before I go to the next page, I'll take a problem. Okay, let's say there was a parabola which was opening upwards. I'm making it as a dotted one because I don't need it actually. So its equation originally was x square is equal to 8y. I shifted this parabola now to this position. Okay, same parabola. Earlier it was at this position, now it has come to this position. Okay, and the vertex now becomes 2, 5, 2. Okay, tell me what would be the new equation. What would be the equation of this fellow? Write it down on the chat box. Sir, what? Sir, we have done this in our graph and its transformations. But no, I mean, some of you have forgotten it, and that's, you know, painful for me to learn that. So I want to reconfirm myself whether you are all aware of this. Okay, so please, once again, for my sake, please do this question and tell me the answer. Thank you, Prasim. Very correct. Yeah. So it becomes x minus 5 the whole square is equal to 8y minus 2. Excellent. Okay. Try one more. Just one more. So let us say there was a parabola which was initially a downward opening parabola. Okay. And let's say its equation was x square is equal to minus 16y. Now this parabola has been shifted to such a place that its vertex has now become minus 3, 4. Okay, so what is the equation of this fellow? No need to simplify and tell all that, Setu. It's fine. In raw form, you give me. Don't worry. Shaduli, a small mistake you have done. Correct, Vaishnav. So it will be x plus 3 the whole square is equal to minus 16y minus 4. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Any questions, any concerns? Some of you have messed up with the signs, so please be careful. Okay. Anyway, so my agenda was to discuss that if somebody gives me a standard form shifted, that means he shifts a standard form and asks me for the vertex, focus, directrix equation, etc., how to do those type of questions. So let's take a sample question here. Find number one, vertex, focus, equation of directrix, length of lateral septum, or before that, equation of axis, length of lateral septum for I'll just take a case here. Let's say 8x plus 2. Okay. Now, there are two ways to solve this question. One is a graphical route. But trust me, from my experience, I figured out that the graphical route is going to be a lengthy way to solve it. Okay. So many people, what they do, they make a graph. Okay. So let me do that way also so that you can get an idea that how lengthy or how cumbersome that approach can be. So the first route is a graph route. So you basically look at this equation and you figure out that, oh, this was actually y square is equal to 4ax case shifted somewhere. Of course, here a value is going to be 2, right? Yes. So it was originally y square is equal to 8x. So I'll just make that graph also for you. Dotted, because that is not our actual graph. This was the old graph or old equation. And now this equation got shifted. And that is why this equation became this equation. And that is why this equation became this equation, right? So now tell me, where did it get shifted? Now looking at it, you will be able to figure out very easily that it got shifted to minus 2 comma 3. So minus 2 comma 3 is somewhere over here, let's say. Okay, so your original equation graph would be appearing like this. Okay, I'm just making a dummy diagram here. Don't judge it by its accuracy. Okay, just a dummy figure. So this vertex has now come to minus 2 comma 3. Okay, so first part answer is done. It's minus 2 comma 3. Second part, where is the focus? Now you already know that focus will be located on the very same line and at a distance of a units from the vertex. Correct. So if this is minus 2 comma 0, where do you think should be the focus? Where do you think should be the focus? So 2 units from here, if you go, this becomes your focus. So focus will become 0 comma 3. Am I right? Correct me if I'm wrong. Correct? Yes or no? So second part of the question also done. Next, equation of the directrix. So please note, directrix would be, again, let me just, sorry for cutting through this point. I'll put it on top, by the way. Yeah. So directrix would be a line which is going to be a line parallel to the y-axis and passing through a point which is again 2 units from here. So this is minus 2 comma 3. So this point will be minus 4 comma 3, isn't it? So can I say this line would be x equal to minus 4? So this answers your third part. Directrix equation is x equal to minus 4. Yes or no? Yes or no? Now, axis equation will be y equal to 3 because it has to pass through the vertex, the focus whose y coordinate is always 3. So y equal to 3. So that answers the fourth part of the question also. LR length, you already know it's 4a units, so which is 8 units. Okay. Now, many people find this method slightly cumbersome because they have to first make the graph and they have to account for, you know, the units here and there. So people find it slightly cumbersome and difficult to handle. But don't worry, I have an easier approach where you would not require any graph at all. So you don't have to sketch the graph at all. And still you can find all your answers exactly the same, exactly to the figures which we have obtained. So let us see the second approach. So this is our first approach through the use of a graph. Okay. Second approach is where I will not use graph at all. So what I will do here is I will do a role change activity. Okay. I call that activity as a role change. Role plays. I'm sure most of you, when you were small, okay, you were all trying to copy something, right? Somebody, and I was like, you know, very infatuated by a police officer. So I was always like, you know, take a dummy gun and do discount everywhere. So I'll be like playing a role of a cop. That's how many kids also play, isn't it? Okay. So if you move around your apartment, you'll see small girls, they will, you know, play some kind of a role. Someone will become mother, someone will become daughter, auntie, uncle, like that and all. Okay. So the same strategy I'm now going to adopt to solve this question. So I'm going to say that this guy y minus 3 whole square is like this. Okay, so this capital Y is basically playing the role of Y minus 3, or you can say Y minus 3 is playing the role of capital Y, and X plus 2 is playing the role of capital X, and of course 4A is 8, so A is 2. Okay, now what I'll do, I will recall everything that I know related to this parabola. So just close your eyes. Imagine Y square is equal to 4AX. So imagine where was the vertex. Imagine where was the focus. Imagine what was the equation of the directrix. Imagine what was the equation of the axis. Imagine what was the lattice vector. Okay. Once you've imagined, let us, you know, try to solve this. So vertex, if you close your eyes, vertex was at 0, 0, right? So what I will do here, I will, instead of writing 0, 0, I will write X is 0, capital X is 0, and capital Y is 0. And then I will make a role change. Capital X is actually small x plus 2, and capital Y is small y minus 3. I'm going to equate it to 0 and solve for my X and solve for Y. So minus 2 comma 3 becomes your vertex position. Did we get the same answer here? Yes, minus 2 comma 3. Okay, so this is all you need to do. There's nothing extra that is required when you are using this method. Second thing, focus. Again, close your eyes. Focus was at A comma 0. So instead of A comma 0, just write one extra step, X equal to A and Y equal to 0. And now change your capital X with X small X plus 2, change your A with 2, change your capital Y with small Y minus 3, and 0 is 0. So solve for X, solve for Y. So 0 comma 3 becomes your focus. 0 comma 3 becomes your focus. Yes, 0 comma 3. I got it again. Okay. Next, try this on your own. Directrix. You know directrix for this curve, capital Y square is equal to 4AX is capital X equal to A, right? Sorry, capital X equal to minus A. So just make a role change now. This is X plus 2. And this is minus 2. So it becomes X equal to minus 4. This becomes your directrix. Did we get the same answer from graphical route as well? Let's check. Yes, same answer. X equal to minus 4. Okay. Now, equation of the axis. Equation of the axis for Y square, capital Y square is equal to 4AX is your X axis. X axis is capital Y equal to 0. Now, capital Y role is being played by small y minus 3. So this answer is your equation of the axis. Did we get the same answer for with the graph approach? Yes, see, y equal to 3. Okay, next, length of the lattice rectum, that is pretty straightforward. That will be 4A units. That is nothing to do with this thing. So 8 units. So this method is very simple to apply. You don't have to make any kind of a graph. You don't have to use your imagination. I would call this method to be, you can say, very, very kind of a straightforward method. Okay. You don't have to sketch any graph. You don't have to imagine where to move by how much to get to which point, etc. Nothing to be done here. Just a role change mechanism. Now, I'm sure you would like to try out your hand at few more questions. Okay, so I will take up few more questions, not to worry. Any questions, any concerns with this? So all you need to do is just imagine which parabola was shifted. So imagine your vertex, focus, equation of directrix, whatever for that parabola, and just do a role change. So just write a capital X equal to 0. Let's say 0, 0 was the vertex. So say capital X equal to 0, capital Y equal to 0. Just change your capital X in terms of small, capital Y in terms of small, and get your small X and small Y. That will become your vertex. Same process is to be followed for other coordinates and equations as well. Okay, let's take the same set of questions. So I'll just take a snapshot of this so that I don't have to write it again and again. Yeah. Find the following five for yeah. And please put your response as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Okay, Noel. Okay. You can't write 4A, you have to give the value. Yeah. Anybody else other than Noel? Okay, Prism. Okay, Setu. Okay, should we discuss it? So as I told you, compare it with the standard case which you have seen. Okay, it is just a shifted version of the standard case, correct? Where your capital X role is being played by X plus 4, capital Y role is being played by Y plus 1, and A is nothing but 4. Okay, now close your eyes and remember everything with respect to this leftward opening parabola. So first of all, vertex 0, 0, right? So 0, 0, you just have to write capital X and capital Y as 0, 0 each. And just equate capital with small x plus 4 and capital Y with small y plus 1. So X is minus 4, Y is minus 1. So minus 4, minus 1 is your vertex. Okay. So if you've got this, absolutely right. Now the focus for this parabola used to be at minus A comma 0. So I will write capital X is minus A and Y is 0. Because the focus was minus A comma 0. Okay. So capital X is X plus 4. This is minus 4. Okay. Capital Y is Y plus 1 equal to 0. Correct. So X becomes minus 8. Y becomes minus 1. So minus 8 comma minus 1 will become your focus. Okay. Some of you have got the focus wrong. Some of you have got the focus wrong. Please check, everybody. Those who have got it wrong. Why it is wrong? Get it clarified. Okay. Next, equation of the directrix here is capital X equal to A. So X plus 4 is equal to 4. That means X equal to 0 is your directrix. X equal to 0 is your directrix. Again, many people have got it wrong. Many people have got it wrong. Yeah. Next, equation of the axis. Equation of the axis in this case for a leftward opening parabola is y equal to 0. So that will give you y plus 1 equal to 0. Okay. And finally, the length of the lattice rectum is 4a, which is 16 units. Okay, let me check. Noel, some mistake was there in your answer. Prishim was absolutely right, I think. Yeah. Karthik, some mistake in your answer. I think Setu also, some mistake. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? See, you need practice. You need a bit of practice. Don't worry, we'll take one more set of questions. Not to worry. Okay. Okay, very good, Karthik. Let's take another one. Same data I want. For x minus 3, the whole square is minus y plus 1. Please find the following for this parabola. This time, be very, very careful. Okay, don't make the mistakes which you made for the previous one. Yes, any success, anybody? Anybody who is willing to respond? Okay, okay. Take your time. 1 minute more I can give. Yeah. Okay, Setu. Okay, Prisham. Yes. Shall we now discuss it? Anybody else who would like to respond? Wants that extra few seconds to write? 30 seconds. Okay, fine. Okay, chalo, finally we'll discuss it. So if you compare this, you have to compare this with x square is equal to minus 4ay, because your 4a has to be 1. That means a has to be 1 by 4. So capital X whole is being paid by small x minus 3 and capital Y whole is being paid by small y plus 1. Okay, now close your eyes and start recalling where was the vertex. Vertex was at origin. So write capital X and capital Y as 0, 0 each to signify origin. So this was 0 and this was 0, which means X is 3 and Y is minus 1, which means 3 comma minus 1 is your vertex. Okay. Next. Focus. For a downward opening parabola, focus used to be at 0, comma minus a. Correct? 0, comma minus a. So capital X is small x plus 3. Sorry, small x minus 3. And capital Y is small y plus 1. Minus a is minus 1 by 4. Okay. So X is equal to 3, Y is equal to minus 5 by 4. So 3 comma minus 5 by 4 will be your focus. 3 comma minus 5 by 4 will be focus. Okay. Gone. Shardali, wrong. Prisham, correct. Setu is also correct. RF Sinha, also correct. Okay. Next. Third, directrix. Directrix for such case used to be y equal to a. So y plus 1 is equal to 1 fourth. So you can write it as 4y plus 3 equal to 0 or y is equal to minus 3 by 4. Both are fine. This time I think most of you are correct in this. Okay, good. Next, axis. Axis equation used to be capital X equal to 0. So in this case, X equal to 3 will be your answer. Okay. This also most of you have got it right. Next, length of the lattice rectum is 4a, which in this case is 4 into 1 by 4, which is 1 unit. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. This time I will give you one question which might, you know, mislead you. Let's say the same set, the same five things, vertex, focus, directrix equation, axis equation, length of lattice rectum for this parabola. Please try this out. Yes, anybody? Okay, Setu, very good. Anybody else? So tomorrow we have a class again. Okay. In tomorrow's session, we are going to talk about, we'll be completing our mathematical reasoning chapter. However, very small part of it is left. And we'll also talk about trigonometric equations. Okay. So that is another chapter which we had to cover under trigonometry. It has been removed from your CBSE curriculum. I agree to that. But still, nevertheless, it is an important part for us for our competitive exams. So we'll take that up. Okay. All right. So let's discuss it. I could see different responses coming in now. Okay, Noel, not to worry. See, actually, if you try to write this as a shifted case of a parabola, it must appear something of this nature. Okay, this is how a shifted parabola should actually appear. Let me write it like this. Plus minus 4a y minus beta, something like this. But right now what I see is that their coefficient of x and y that you see here should be directly be 1. I mean, indirectly it is something else, but directly it should be actually 1. Okay. So I have to convert, first of all, my equation to something of this nature before I start working on it. So first of all, I would try to get this 2 away from x. So for that, I need to take 2 out. So, but that 2 will come out as a 4, and that will leave me with something like this. Okay. Similarly, I want y to come over here. So minus 4 has to be taken common out. In fact, this 4 and minus 4, you can drop it out. You can do like this. Now, this is the form which I desire. This is the form which I had basically started learning this concept. So now this is where we'll start solving the problem by role change mechanism. So your cap, this is like capital X square is equal to minus 4 minus 4 a y. So a here will be 1 by 4, capital X will be small x minus 3 by 2, and capital Y will be small y minus 3. Okay. Now close your eyes, recall everything that you knew about this parabola. So it's a downward opening parabola, right? So let's talk about vertex. Let's talk about vertex. So vertex was at 0, 0. So x minus 3 by 2 is 0, y minus 3 is 0. So 3 by 2 comma 3 is the vertex. I believe most of you have got it right. Next, focus. Focus for such case was x equal to 0 and y equal to minus a, because it's a downward opening parabola. So this is equal to 0 and y means y minus 3 equal to minus a. Minus a will be minus 1 by 4. Okay. So if I'm not mistaken, x value will be 3 by 2 and y value will be 3 minus 1 by 4, which is actually 11 by 4. So 3 by 2 comma 11 by 4 is your vertex. 3 by 2 comma 11 by 4. 3 by 2 comma 11 by 4. No, Prisham, that is not right. Noel, that's correct. Karthik, not right. Setu, correct. Okay. Next. Equation of the directrix. Equation of the directrix was, for this case, y equal to a. So y minus 3 is equal to 1 fourth. So y is equal to 3 plus 1 fourth, which is going to be 13 by 4. So you can say 4y minus 13 equal to 0. 4y, correct, Noel? Prisham, again wrong. Karthik, no. Setu, correct. Next. Axis equation for this case was your capital X equal to 0. So that will make X equal to 3 by 2. Or you can say 2X minus 3 equal to 0 also. Okay. Lattice rectum length will be 4A units, which is 4 into 1 by 4, which is 1 unit. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Why are we not taking minus y minus c? What do you mean by that? I've already taken minus 5, minus 3. So 4 minus is this minus. 4a is 1. So a is 1 by 4. And capital Y is small y minus 3. In calculating the third part, for a downward opening parabola, directrix equation is y equal to a only. No? But in this case, for our case, it will be capital Y equal to a, because that's what I've taken. No? What mistake you have done? Probably you have taken your capital Y as minus Y minus times Y minus 3, which is wrong. We can't take Y like that. That minus is just signifying that it's a downward opening case. If this is not correct, don't expect your answer to be right. All the things will go for a toss, other than the vertex probably, because there's a 0, 0 that will save you. Right? Okay, so this type of, okay. Now another type of question which is asked with respect to the same thing is that the question setter might not give you like this, like how I used to give in the previous few questions. So I was actually kind enough to give you the question like this. Don't expect the examiners to be kind enough to give you like that. They will actually give you questions like this. Let me show you. Okay, so they'll give you something like this. They will say, find the vertex, focus, lateral sector, axis, directrix of this parabola. So it is your headache to complete the square and do the needful. Okay, so let's do this problem. So for this parabola, find the following: vertex, focus, lateral sector, length, axis of the parabola, directrix equation. Parabola's general form is something which contains everything. Usme x square bhi hoga, y square bhi hoga, xy bhi hoga. Okay, so unlike in circle where there was no xy term and the coefficient of x square and y square were equal and kept as one, in case of a parabola, we don't have that kind of a restriction. Of course, there is a condition that will be told to you when I do pair of straight lines. Okay, but as such, there is no general form to answer your question. It is as good as a general form of any conic. Yes, Any questions? See, first of all, I would like to ask you this question before you solve it. Is this a standard form of a parabola or a shifted form of a standard parabola or any parabola in general? That means it could be oblique also. Which case does it fall under and why? Is it a standard parabola? First of all, answer that question with yes or no. Is this a standard parabola? Yeah, Shardul, we will come back to that. Is this a standard parabola, first of all? Just answer yes or a no for that. Are you? Say something. 23 of you are sitting. Nobody knows the answer to this. Right, Siddharth. It is not a standard form. Because standard form either will look like y square equal to something x or x square equal to something y. Right. But it has other terms also. For example, x square, x also, y also, constant also. So it is not a standard case. Is it a oblique case? Could it be a parabola like this, inclined like something like this? Yes or no? Could it be like this? No, it cannot be, Nikhil. If it is an inclined parabola, it will definitely contain an xy term. Because in that case, your directrix will also be inclined. And remember, when you will write that locus condition, you will get that in that distance expression, you will end up getting hk term also. So is there any xy term in this parabola? No. If there is no xy term, it is not an oblique case also. So what is left? So if it is not a standard case, it is not a teha case, it is a shifted case in that case. Exactly. Are you getting my point? So the point which I wanted to convey to this small question that I asked was that if you see an xy term in the parabola, then only it's a case where the parabola is slightly tilted one like that. Okay. If there is only x square y or y square x kind of a term, then it's a standard case, something like this, right? But in this case, it is neither of the two, which means it is a shifted version. Okay, so for shifted version, we need to complete our squares. So for that, normally, this is the mechanism that I suggest. So look at these two terms, keep these two terms separately. So in order to complete a square, what would you require here? You would require a 16, correct? So just add a 16 on both the sides of the equation. So this becomes x plus 4 the whole square. And send these two guys to the other side. Okay. And as I told you in the previous question, you should always have the direct coefficient of x and y to be 1, 1 each. So I have to take a minus 12 common. Getting the point here? So looking at this, now you'll realize, oh, it is now this parabola which was shifted. So your A is 3, capital X is X plus 4, capital Y is Y minus 1, correct? Yes or no? Correct? So now close your eyes and recall everything related to this. So vertex was 0, 0. Vertex was 0, 0. So write capital X as 0, capital Y as 0. So X plus 4 is 0, Y minus 1 equal to 0. So 4 comma, minus 4 comma 1 is your vertex. Let me check. Prisham, you are doing again same mistakes. Sharduli also, same mistake. Anybody who got this right? I think nobody got it right. You should actually know why you're making that mistake. Okay, focus. focus for this case is at 0, comma, minus a. So x plus 4 will be 0 and y minus 1 equal to minus a. Now minus a here is minus 3. So x is minus 4, y is minus 2. So minus 4, comma, minus 2 is your focus. Many people got this wrong. In fact, all of you almost got it wrong. Anyways, we'll take more questions. Since you have got it wrong, I'll take more questions. Directrix equation. In such case, directrix equation is y equal to a. Okay, so our y is y minus 1, a is equal to 3. So y equal to 4 is our directrix, or y minus 4 equal to 0 is our directrix. Next, what they have asked, lattice rectum length. Okay, lattice rectum length will be 4a units, which is 12. They've also asked us the equation of the axis, I believe. Axis in this case is capital X equal to 0, which is this. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns here now? Post this exercise, I don't think so. There should be any issue. So completing a perfect square, along with the fact that your direct coefficient, I'm not talking about indirect coefficient. Indirect coefficient is like when you expand it. Your direct coefficient should be made 1-1 for them, and that part should be taken as your capital X, capital Y, etc. And then you have to work with this standard form. Is it fine? Let's take one more. Sorry, I know your break is getting delayed, but till you get this right, sir, we are feeling hungry. Okay, let's take this one. Just one question here, vertex. You don't have to do all the parts. And I'll put the pole also on for the same. Find the vertex of this parabola. Again, first ask yourself, is it a standard form? No. Is it an oblique form? Slightly tilted parabola? No, because there is no xy term. So it has to be a shifted form. Shifting of what? Standard case. So some standard form was shifted. Then you got this equation. Okay, very good. I've got one of the options getting some response. So post this question, we'll take a break. On the other side of the break, I will introduce you to the parametric form of the standard cases. And we will talk a little bit related to questions related to parametric form also. Okay, 2 minutes have already gone. I can give 30 more seconds, not more than that. Five, four, three, two, one, cool. Okay, just 7 of you could muster the courage to respond. Why? You're all scared, huh? You'll get it wrong. Don't be scared. Okay, so out of 7 of you, 5 say A and 2 say B. Okay, so A and B, there is some split of votes. See, again, The presence of a y squared term says that there has to be a perfect square created in y, which is clearly obtained when you put a 1 here. So that becomes y minus 1 the whole square. This, in fact, this will become minus 12 minus 6x. Correct me if I'm wrong. Note that I need to ensure my direct coefficient of x and y both are 1 each. Okay, so this is how I need to write it first. Okay, so now compare it with y square is equal to minus 4ax, which means your capital X role is being played by small x plus 2, capital Y role is being played by y minus 1, and A role is being played by 3 by 2, correct? Now, anyways, we don't need to go into a value also. We just needed the vertex. So vertex is where x is 0, y is 0. That means x plus 2 is 0, y minus 1 equal to 0. So x is minus 2, y is 1. So minus 2 comma 1 is your vertex. And that's clearly option number A. Up to you. So I'll leave this question on your screen only. Please find out everything else. Meanwhile, those who want to take a break, you can take a break. 6:25 right now as per my laptop. And okay, we'll meet exactly at 6:40 p.m. Okay, on the other side, we'll talk about parametric forms. See you after the break. So next in line is our parametric form of the standard parabola. In fact, we'll just name it as a parametric form. Okay. As I already discussed with you during the circle chapter, parametric form is just an alternate way of expressing the same equation, where instead of directly relating the variables, you relate the variables to a parameter. And if you eliminate that parameter, the relationship between the variable becomes the same as the equation. We are done in case of a circle, x square plus y square is equal to r square. We had learned that the parametric form was x equal to r cos theta and y equal to r sine theta. In the same way, we'll have parametric forms for our parabola as well. So let us begin with first our standard cases. So if this is the Cartesian form of our standard form of a parabola, what could be a suggested parametric form? Again, I'm using the word suggested because parametric forms are not fixed. Okay. Unlike the equation in Cartesian form, which is fixed. That means there is no alternate equation to the same thing. Okay. Of course, you can, you know, change the way you write the same expression, but parametric forms can vary as per person to person. So that is why we don't use the parametric form. We use a parametric form or suggested parametric form. So for such cases, the parametric form that we normally use or which is conventionally used is this: x equal to at square, y equal to 2at, where t is a parameter. And you can see for yourself that if you eliminate the t from both the equations, you will end up getting the same equation back. So if you eliminate your t, you end up getting the same equation back. Okay. Right. Should we check it out? So from the last equation, I can say t is equal to y by 2a and put this in the first equation. So x equal to a, and instead of t, I will put y by 2a the whole square. So that will give you x equal to a times y square by 4a square. A will get cancelled. So this gives you y square is equal to 4ax. Okay. So the use of parametric form, as you already know, is to represent a point, any point which is not actually known to us. So let's say if I want to choose a point on this parabola, y square is equal to 4ax. I would actually choose it like something at square comma 2at. Okay, I will not choose x1 y1 or I will not choose alpha beta etc, because unnecessarily two variables will get involved. So here, if you see, the benefit of parametric form is that you can do away by choosing a point with only one variable involved, which is t in this case. Okay. And not only that, if you, you know, see, this automatically speaks for itself. It says that, hey, I have a point on the parabola. Okay. So you don't have to see, give an extra information to the viewer that x1, y1 are such points which will satisfy y1 square is equal to 4ax1. So it has double advantage. One, the number of variable used is only one. And secondly, the point speaks for itself. That means the point automatically says that it lies on that given curve. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns here? Okay. Now I would request you to tell me or suggest me a parametric form for the second standard case, y square is equal to minus 4ax. Let me see what is your suggestion in this case. By the way, can you all see me? I am in darkness actually. It's because the power is gone. It's on the backup right now. Yes, very good, Nikhil. So as you can all observe here that the sine of x became minus x. So you can write x as minus 80 square, y as 280. Very good. Okay, so this is a parametric form for y square is equal to minus 4ax. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Okay. Try the third one. Tell me for x square is equal to 4ay. Suggest me a parametric form for x square is equal to 4ay. Very good. Excellent. So x equal to 280 and y is equal to 80 square. Very good. So basically you have used the fact that this equation is obtained by replacing x and y or swapping x and y positions. So even in the parametric form, whatever was your x earlier, that will become the y here. So earlier my x was 80 square. Here my y will become 80 square. And my y was 280. So here x will become 280. Excellent, where t is a parameter. Okay. Tell me the parametric form for x square is equal to minus 4ay. Now, this is not a challenge for you because you'll just say change the sign of y. Absolutely. So it will be y equal to minus 80 square. Okay. So this is a suggested parametric form. Parametric forms are going to be of lot of use when we do this conic section chapter to more depth. Okay. In fact, any conic section, the parametric form has a huge role to play. Don't take it lightly. I know it is not there in your CBSE curriculum, but this concept is going to be very, very useful when it comes to solving locus-based questions. Okay. Later on, we'll talk about locus-based questions on conic sections. Okay. So now I will just give you a small question to solve here. Suggest a parametric form for x minus 2 the whole square minus 4y plus 1. Yes, anybody, any success? Then, see, all you need to do is just compare this with y square is equal to minus 4a. Sorry, x square is equal to minus 4ay. So for such case, if you recall, we had just done it in the last page. Your x is equal to 2at and y is equal to minus at square. Am I right? Okay. Now, all you need to do is change your capital X with x minus 2, small x minus 2. And here, remember, a is 1. So this will become 2t. Correct? Remember, a is 1. So it will become 2t. And your y plus 1 is equal to minus t square. Correct? So you can write the suggested parametric form for this as x as 2 plus 2t and y as minus t square minus 1. Okay? Where t is a parameter, please state that also. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns here? Do let me know. Fine. Okay. So now I have a small set of questions based on the parametric form for you all. Please copy this down. And if you have any questions, any concerns, do let me know because I'm going to switch to the next slide. Clear? No doubt? Okay. Okay, so here is a question for all of you. This is our standard parabola y square is equal to 4ax. Okay. Y square is equal to 4ax. Okay. And this is a focal chord. Okay, of course, focal chord is a chord passing through the focus. Let's say this extreme end is P, this extreme end is Q. Okay, this point, the parameter is T1. In other words, the coordinate of this point is AT1 square comma 2AT1. And this point, the parameter is T2. In other words, the coordinates of that point is AT2 square comma TAT2. Okay. Question is find the value of T1, T2. Find the value of the product T1, T2. Is the question clear to everybody? Question is this is our standard form of the parabola y square is equal to 4ax. There is a focal chord. One end of the focal chord has a parameter T1. See, when I say that there's a point with parameter T1, indirectly, I'm trying to say that the point coordinate is AT1 square comma 2AT1. Because in light of the parametric form that we discussed, for this, the suggested parametric form is x equal to AT square, y equal to 2AT. In that, T is T1. That is what is the meaning of the point having a parameter of T1. Now, many people ask this question, sir, how do I know that the question setter, has used that parametric form? So this is by convention. If let's say the question says parameter is T1, conventionally, the same parametric form that I discussed, that will be used. Okay. So to this problem, tell me what is the value of product of T1, T2? Very simple question. Very, very simple question. Give me a response on the chat box. Very good, Nikhil. Excellent. That's correct answer. Okay, so Nikhil has already got it. Anybody else? Okay, so guys, this is not a rocket science. You can clearly see that P, S, Q are collinear, right? Okay, because they are on the same focal cord, right? What does it mean? It means slope of P, S or slope of S, P should be same as slope of S, Q. That's it. This will help you to get your answer. So what is the slope of S, P? Y2 minus Y1. By x2 minus x1. Similarly, what is the slope of SQ? Y2 minus y1 by x2 minus x1. Okay. Drop your two A's and A's from the both the sides. So 2A, 2A, I'll cancel. In fact, your A will also get cancelled. So that will leave you with T1 by T1 square minus 1 equal to T2 equal to T2 by T2 square minus 1. Just take a cross multiplication. Okay, just expand it. So that will give you T1, T2 square minus T1 equal to again T1 square T2 minus T2. Bring it this to the other side and bring this to the other side. So T1, T2 square minus T1 square T2 is equal to T1 minus T2. Okay. Very good, Shardali. That's right. Take T1, T2 common. And here you take a minus sign. Now these two will get cancelled, giving you T1, T2 as a minus 1. Okay. Now remember here, T1 is not equal to T2 because P and Q are different points. Remember, T1, T2 are like the Aadhaar card numbers for those points. So assuming that the point is a resident and the curve is a country, every resident has a different Aadhaar card number, right? That is what I told you when I was talking about the parametric form in your circles chapter. So this point has a different parameter than this point. Two parameters cannot be the same unless until the points are same. Please get this right. Two points cannot have the same parameter. It's like two people having the same Aadhaar card. Not possible. Unless until somebody has committed a fraud. Okay. So please understand, P and Q are different points. So T1 and T2 cannot be equal. If they're equal, they have to be same points. That is why you can easily cancel out T1, T2 from both the sides. And that's what I was expecting you to give me. Minus one is your answer. Okay. So this is actually a very important property that you would have to remember in a long run, because a lot of questions have been based around this fact that the extremities of a focal cord, the extremities of the focal cord of a parabola, the parameters are related by the relation T1, T2 equal to minus 1. Please note this down. Very, very important. That means if the parameter of one end is T1, the parameter of the other end will be minus 1 by T1. Okay, so let me show you. If the parameter of one end is T1, let's say this is a focal cord. Okay. So if the parameter of this is T1, that means if this is a T1 square comma 2a T1, the parameter at the other end will be minus 1 by T1, which is nothing but a by T1 square comma minus 2a by T1. So automatically, the same parameter could now be used to get the other extreme end of the focal cord. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Now, once you have known this, let's talk about the focal radius. Focal radius means the distance of the focus from that given point. We also call sometimes this as focal distance. So for this purpose, again, I will take up my standard form. As you can see, standard form is the frog in the laboratory. We keep on doing a lot of findings using the standard form. Okay. So let's say if I have a point here. Okay. Again, I'll take a parametric form. AT square comma 280. What is the distance of this point from the focus? A comma 0. What is SP distance? Please tell me, everybody. Tell me this answer in 5 seconds. Let's see if anybody is able to get this in 5 seconds. What, sir? 5 seconds is too less. But it is actually worth a 5 second. That is why I am giving you only 5 seconds. Give me the distance SP, where P is your point, AT square comma 280. I think it's almost a minute now. SP, Shardili, I want SP length. S is this, P is this. What is the length SP? Right. How did you find that out, Setu? Why nahi karna tha? You didn't have to use the distance formula. Use the fact that SP is equal to PM. And this is already X equal to minus A. That means this length is A. This length is already AT square. Right? So answer is A plus AT square. Okay. Now that is the reason why I said use only 5 seconds to solve this. Anyways, since you have found it, there are some things which I will, prove by using this particular form. All of you, please now follow the proof of the fact that lattice rectum. So proof of the fact that lattice rectum is the shortest focal chord. Okay. So I'll be using this focal radius or your focal distance concept to prove that the lattice rectum is the shortest focal chord. Okay. All of you, please pay attention. That's why I don't draw freehand, because it doesn't come out to be very aesthetic. Anyways, I think I've done a good job here. Okay, let's say this is your focal chord. Any focal chord where this point is, let's say P, this point is Q. Now, do you all recall that if this point is AT square comma 280, what will be the coordinates of Q? What will be the coordinates of Q? Write down on the chat box. If P is one extreme end of the focal chord, what is the coordinate of the other? Look at this P and tell me what is the coordinate of Q. If PQ is a focal chord. Nikhil, you're missing something. You wrote behind, where? Where behind? Oh, in the previous slide, on the mirror. Oh, you could see a mirror in my house. Okay, is this fine? Achha, now everybody please pay attention. SP length, just now we told A plus AT square. So can I say, if I want SQ length, it will be A plus A by T square. Am I right? Shardulis, minus sign, you have put at the wrong place. Are you all convinced with SP and SQ? Everybody's convinced? So just like SP was A plus AT squared, that means add A to the X coordinate of P. In the same way, SQ will be A plus the X coordinate of Q, which is A by T squared. So now the focal chord length will be what? A plus AT squared, A plus A by T squared, correct? In short, it is going to become 2A plus AT squared plus A by T squared. Okay. Now, everybody please pay attention. Do you recall that in one of the chapters, I had done the fact that for positive quantities, arithmetic mean is always greater than or equal to geometric mean? Yes or no? For positive quantities? Do you remember that? Which chapter we had done this? Let me see whether you remember the chapter name. What, sir? This is sequence series. Yes, very good. Now I'm going to apply that to this guy. So let's say AT square is one number. And A by T square is another number. Do you all agree that these are positive numbers? So can I say AM? AM will be greater than or equal to GM. Correct? Now T square goes. This will be A, correct? That means, can I say AT square plus A by T square will be greater than or equal to 2A? Yes or no? So can I say this guy will be greater than or equal to 2A plus 2A, because 2A is already there and this fellow is just now, we figured out that this is greater than 2A. So using this over here, can I say this fellow PQ will always be greater than or equal to 2a plus 2a? Yes or no? Right? Yes, if you're convinced. Right? No, if you're not. Yes, you have full freedom to write no also. I will explain once again then. Right? Yes, if you're convinced. Right? No, if you're not. Very good. So yes, people are saying yes. Okay, good. That means PQ is always greater than 4A. Correct? That means the least value of PQ will be 4A. Correct? And 4A is nothing but the length of lattice sector. Correct? That means the least value of the length of any focal chord is your lattice sector length. In other words, lattice rectum is the shortest focal chord. Convinced? That means lattice rectum is the shortest focal chord, because any focal chord is actually greater than or equal to 4A. So the least value of any focal chord is 4A. And that is nothing but the length of the lattice rectum. Convinced? Any question, any concerns? Do let me know. Do let me know. Okay. Copied, noted down. Any questions also, if you have, please ask. Least value. All right. Okay. Great. So let's have few more questions over here. Let's take this question. prove that the semi-lattice rectum of the parabola y square is equal to 4ax is the harmonic mean between the segments of any focal chord of the parabola. Read this question. I'll read it thrice till you understand it. And somebody please explain me, what does the question actually say? Let's see whether you're able to understand the meaning of the question first of all. Yes. Has anybody understood the question? Okay. All I could know is the semi-lattice rectum length here, and there is some focal chord. Okay. Let's call it as TQS. Now tell me, what does the question want you to prove? Anyone who has understood the question, please explain it to me. What does the question want you to prove? Nobody has understood the question. Half of the length of the lattice rectum is harmonic mean of any two focal chords. Sorry, Nikhil, the question doesn't mean that. But good try. I always appreciate trying. Okay, whether you're right or wrong, it is immaterial to me. I want you to participate. I want you to make an attempt to solve the question. Anybody else? Nikhil, well done, but that is not the meaning of the question. Anybody else? See, the reason why I'm asking you this, because this has been written in a very, you can say, very vague way. Okay, that is what I wanted to say. See, the question actually tells you that you need to prove that, let's say this is L1. This is L2. Okay. You need to show that L1, 2A, 2A is your semi-lattice rectum, and L2 are in HP. Okay, this is what the question wants you to prove. Okay. So prove that L1, 2A, and L2 are in harmonic progression. By the way, this is a very important property also. Later on, we will see. While we are doing parabola in much more depth, it's an important property also. Now do this. I'm waiting for you to do this. Now that you know your concepts, you can do it now. Try this out. Just say you're done when you're done, okay? It's a prove that question anyhow. There's nothing to find. By the way, let me tell you, we have crossed our school requirement, okay? I have gone, more than what the school requires for you to know in parabola. In fact, for all the chapters that we have done so far. But let me tell you, this is not the end of this chapter. we have 80% concept more left. Okay, 80%. That means four times whatever we have done is still left to be covered. So big is this chapter. In fact, so big is every conic section chapter. Okay. So once we have some more time left after we are done with the, you know, finishing of our syllabus and doing some practice, we will come back slowly and slowly to these topics in more detail. Danzo, very good. Setu, anybody else? Chalo, we'll discuss this out. See, if you have to prove this, that means you are supposed to prove that 1 by L1, 1 by 2A, and 1 by L2 are in AP. Correct? That means twice of the middle term is sum of this. That is, you need to prove this. Okay? In other words, you have to prove 1 by A is 1 by L1 plus 1 by L2. Okay, let's try to prove it now. Let us start with my right hand side. 1 by L1. Now, first of all, what is L1? I already discussed L1, that is your SP length, is A plus, let's say I call this point to be 80 square comma 280. So by the fact that they are ends of a focal chord, this becomes A by T square minus 2A by T. So L1 is nothing but SP. And SP is nothing but PM, and PM is A plus the X coordinate of that point. So 1 by L1 is 1 by A plus AT square. Okay. Similarly, L2 is what? L2 will be A plus A by T square. In other words, it is A plus AT square by T square. So 1 by L2 is what? T square. Where did I write a square here? Sir, you have written it in subscript. Yeah. This is your 1 by L2. Now add it, see what happens. Add 1 by L1, 1 by L2. Take A plus AT square common. Okay. Take A common in the denominator. These two will get cancelled, giving you 1 by A, which is nothing but your left hand side. Hence proved. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Okay. So we are now going to, you know, take some, you know, questions in general. We have already done more than enough, more than what is required for your school. So we'll take some questions. Okay. So for the next 10-12 minutes of our class, we will solve few questions. So keep this in mind. This is actually a very important property. You would be requiring it. I have seen this question coming in several competitive exams, including CET, Manipal, VIT, of course, JE Main, etc. These questions, this question has actually come as it is. Okay, so let's take a few more questions and then we'll close the topic. Let's take this question. Find the equation of the parabola whose focus is 4, minus 3 and vertex is 4, minus 1. Okay, if you make a diagram, things will be clear here. See, they have said the focus is at 4, minus 3 and the vertex is at 4, minus 1. So 4, minus 1 would be somewhere over here. okay? And 4 comma minus 3 will be somewhere down here, okay? So this is 4 comma minus 1. This is 4 comma minus 3, okay? So this is your parabola. Yes or no? Now, okay, I'll not give you any further hint. I'll just wait for you to complete this. So we all realize that it's a shifted version of a downward opening parabola. So that should answer everything now. Very good, Nikhil. Anybody else? I thought it was an easy question. Many of you would be giving the answer well within a minute. Okay, Prisham, Setu, well done. Setu's answer seems to be, Prisham's answer seems to be slightly different than Setu's answer and I think Nikhil's answer. Should we discuss it? See, yeah, you can change your answer. See, guys, here we realize that this is a shifted version of your downward opening parabola, correct? So its equation should be inspired by x square is equal to minus 4ay, correct? Now, since your vertex has come to 4, 1, your capital X will now be small x minus 4 and capital Y will be y plus 1. But what is my A? To know that, I have already told you A represents the distance between the focus and the vertex. So our A is 2 here, correct? So all I need to do is write this, okay? So that is nothing but x minus 4 the whole square is minus 8y plus 1. That's it. So if you expand it and write it in a proper way, you are most welcome to do that. But I was basically interested in just knowing the format here. So it's x square. I'm so sorry. It's x square minus 8x plus 8y plus 24 equal to 0. Well done, Nikhil. Nikhil got it absolutely right. Others who have made a mistake, please know why you have made a mistake. That is more important. Come on. We are closing this chapter and such mistakes are happening. Let's take this question. Find the equation of the parabola whose axis is parallel to the y-axis and which passes through these three points and determine the length of its lattice vector. Determine the length of its lattice vector. Equation of the parabola with axis parallel to y-axis and passes through these three points. And you have to also find the length of the lattice vector. Yes, anybody? Okay, now everybody please pay attention. See, this type of a parabola, which is parallel to the y-axis, whose axis is parallel to the y-axis, is nothing but a quadratic polynomial. See, in quadratic polynomial, we always used to make a parabola like this or like this, right? So all these have their axis parallel to y-axis only, right? Now, because there are three unknowns involved here, A, B, C, there are three points provided to us. Okay, so we need to get these three points. These three unknowns. So let us use the first point, 4, 0. So put 4 as A and 4 as Y. Okay, and this will be obtained. C is obtained. Correct. Put Y as 9. Okay. X as 1, so that gives you A plus B as a 5. Okay. Then put 4, 5, so put Y as 5 and X as a 4. Okay, so this gives you, I think, 1 equal to 16 A plus 4 B. Right? Now using these two, we'll have to solve for A and B because C is already known. Okay, so let's solve A and B. So let's multiply the first equation with a 4. And let's subtract it. So 12A is minus 19. So A value will be minus 19 by 12. Put it over here. So B value will be 5 minus A. 5 minus A will be this, which is nothing but 79 by 12. Okay. So let's put this back in our equation, y equal to a x square, which is, very good. Prasim actually got it. Well done. Okay. Then b is 79 by 12x and c is a 4. Okay. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Is it fine? All right. So I think we have covered up enough content on parabola to suffice your school needs. But as I told you, this chapter is not yet over. We have at least 4 times more content left to be covered. We will talk about it in near future. Okay. So thank you. Bye-bye. Good night. Stay safe. Shabba khair. Shubh Ratri. Bye-bye.
Sir?